I'm going to review the rigid body dynamics. I use this double pendulum example a lot because this gives you the full flavor of the rigid body kinematics. Also, it has many applications. If I draw the rigid double pendulum like this, then this could be, I don't know, maybe if I draw this way, you may wonder what I'm drawing, but this is the helicopter. So this is the helicopter blade, and this whole body is the helicopter. On the other hand, if I draw this way, maybe like this, this is the what? This is the robot arm. So it has this double pendulum occurs in many mechanisms. What else I could imagine? I don't know. Okay, so let's say let me just looking at the one pendulum, starting from the one pendulum. Okay, this is my origin, rotating point, say O. This is rotating this way. I mean, this is the positive rotating direction, which means that I have a coordinates, inertial coordinates, which doesn't rotate. And this is maybe my x inertial coordinates. This is my y inertial coordinates. And z inertial is coming out here. Say that this angular velocity is okay, I measured the angle from here. No, I better measure. Okay, I better measure from the x. Then I should draw different way. But it doesn't matter. Okay, I just measured the angle from here. This is theta. Then I put another coordinate at the tip of this pendulum. So y body coordinate is aligned with this first pendulum, and x is perpendicular to that. So this is perpendicular. I should say this is also perpendicular, and this is xv. Oops. XV and this is YV. So XV, YV, this is attached to here. Let's call this point B. So it's moving with the first pendulum. So like this. So move like this. This way or that way. So say, imagine that you are at the tip of this axis. You are sitting in here. You are looking at something. If it doesn't move, from your point of view, if it doesn't move, which means that the other object is exactly the same rotating velocity with me, right? That's why it doesn't look like moving from your point of view. So when you take the derivative, so you have to take into account those motion that you cannot see from the moving coordinates. I mean, if something, some quantity is expressed in moving coordinates, what I mean is that So this is any quantity. Could be velocity, acceleration, position, angle, angular velocity, anything. Any physical quantity. So let's, what should I call? Q. Okay, let's say this is Q. Some quantity, vector quantity. But this is expressed in the body moving coordinates. So when you take the derivative of this by time, if you just take the normal derivative, which is that the remainder all this unit vector, and you only take the derivative in front of unit vector, so this is what that means, then you won't see, you haven't considered the effect that why, because of you are moving. Then you won't see that effect. So if you're only taking the derivative as usual, you haven't included this rotating effect yet. Right? For example, here, you are sitting here, there's something here, some object, say M, some object. Let's go ahead, let's say. So you measure that the coordinates of this M. So this is Q. If this M rotates exactly same as synchronized with this first pendulum, then you won't see it, right? If you take the derivative, then this part would be zero. But you cannot say this is zero because this is actually moving. It's only it doesn't look like moving because you are moving together. So when you're taking the derivative here, you have to add this rotating effect. That's why you have to include this. So this is body coordinates. This omega, this is the rotating angular velocity of body coordinates. So in this case, what would be the angular velocity of this body coordinate? Which is, that's theta dot, right? So in this case, this example, this omega is just theta dot, and vector is k. So whenever something is expressed in this coordinate, body coordinate, and you have to take the derivative, whatever it is, it could be coordinates, distance vector, position vector, or velocity vector, or acceleration, whatever it is, when you take the derivative, not only you have to do this, also you have to do this part. You have to add. Once you understand this, the rest of them is just algebra. So now let's add the second pendulum. Now I add the second pendulum, attach it to B. So this is the second pendulum. If I'm looking at the second pendulum from the body coordinate, I only see this movement of the second pendulum relative to the first pendulum. You don't see the movement of the first pendulum because you are moving together with the first pendulum, right? The reason that we are introducing this moving coordinate is because that when you express the movement of the second pendulum, if you don't use this, you have to consider the movement of first and second jointly. That makes it a bit complicated. But if you are sitting in the first pendulum, you basically canceling the movement of first pendulum. And looking from there to the second pendulum, you only see the movement of second pendulum. The only thing you have to consider is this. When you take the derivative, you have to add this. That's it. So expression getting simpler, but the price you have to pay is that taking the derivative, you have to add this rotating effect. Any question? So if I ask the, for example, some point here, what's the velocity of this point? Then you have to establish the vector all the way from the origin, fixed coordinate, to this vector. So you have this is R vector, if I say, and you have to express this R vector. Then it's quite complicated if you try to express this using only this inertial coordinates, because this pendulum is moving and this pendulum is moving, so it's a bit complicated. But if you use the, instead of R, if you break down that vector to two vector, starting from O to here, B, and the B to here, two vector, the same vector, so this, let's say this is R1, this is R2, then I can write down R vector is sum R1 plus R2. R1 vector, position of B, it could be easily written down in the inertial coordinates. Position of R2 from starting from B is very convenient to write down in terms of body coordinates. So then once you take the derivative, because this is inertial coordinate, so it doesn't matter, it's just a normal derivative. Second one is body coordinate, so you have to take the normal derivative plus rotating velocity of the body coordinate. In fact, let's write down. So R1, this is theta, so let me redraw here. So this is the R1 vector here. So this is xi, this is yi, this angle is theta, this is R1 vector. So R1 vector can be easily written down in terms of inertial coordinates. So R1, x component is, let's say this length is let's say L1, then L1 times sine theta. This is I direction. J direction is minus L1 cosine theta J. So I write down this R1 vector in terms of inertial coordinates. What about the second pendulum? Second pendulum is here, so this is B, so let's say B is here, and my moving coordinates, this is XB, YB is towards the parallel to the first pendulum, and second pendulum looked like this, and this is R2. Let's call this angle is theta 2. Then R2, I can write down, if this length is, again I said the length is L2, then L2 sine theta 2, I better put 1 here. 1, 1, 1. Theta 2, but this is now rotating vector IB minus L2 cosine theta 2. JB. So this is, you can see now, this is expressed in the body coordinate. Taking the derivative, you take a usual derivative You can take the derivative of this. L1 is constant, so only you have to take derivative of theta. Then you have to use chain rule. First take derivative by theta, and then d theta by dt. Same thing for cosine theta as well. Here's the same thing, similar fashion, but you will have the derivative of this ib and jb. Whenever ib and jb appears, you replace by d by dt. For example, ib is just omega cross ib. Then you plug in the, all the numbers, and you will get the velocity. Okay. Let me give you an example. That this is the first quiz problem of the fourth tutorial. So example was first problem in the tutorial number four. This was I was asking this wheel. So radius r. Is rolling. This is rotating, but not just rotating. This is basically wheels, so it's rotating and moving forward. Now ask the. Calculate the velocity at each different point of the wheel boundary. Then what you can do is you set up the coordinates here. So this is fixed coordinates. So xi, yi. Intentionally, I make it this is aligned with the center so that the center y-axis is zero, and then I put the rotating coordinates on the center of the this wheel, so it will rotate with the wheel. I put this body coordinates here. So this is xb, yb. If I choose any point here at the boundary, say that this angle is theta, and your vector all the way from this inertial coordinate origin to this vector, this is the vector you have to differentiate to get the velocity. But instead of taking this vector derivative, you break down this vector, same as in the double pendulum. You break down into two vectors. R1 vector is starting from the origin of the inertial coordinate to the origin of the body coordinates. So this is my R1. And from here to the point that I'm interested in, that's R2. So this is R1, this is R2. So R1 again, R1 again, this is more convenient to write down in terms of inertial coordinates. It has only x component. This is the position from the center to the origin of the inertial coordinates to the center of the wheel. So this is only has a x coordinates. Let's say that distance is L times xi. Xi, you know, unit vector is this. R2, this better be in the body coordinates. I said the radius of this wheel is, I think, did I say? Okay, I didn't say anything. let's say this radius of the wheel is, let's say, R. No, R would be confusing. I ran out of the symbols. L2. It's not a very good symbol, I would say, but let's say L2. So then this x coordinates of R2 vector is L2 times cosine theta IB now, and y coordinates is L2 sine theta JB. Take the there's a few tricky things happens if you take the derivative. R1 derivative is just L dot. You don't need to take derivative I, so L dot. Well, how do I calculate the L dot? Is I think I give you the angular velocity. So this rotating angular velocity, say for example omega, which is theta dot, this is constant. This is a condition that I gave you. So the forwarding velocity will be constant. If you're looking at the center, this forwarding velocity will be constant. Then you only thing you have to do is taking the, when it one ton, the wheel takes the 1 ton, how much time to take this 1 ton, and the distance to going forward by taking 1 ton is just the same as the length of the edge of the circle, which is 2 pi L2. How much time to take the 1 ton? I give you the omega, right? Angular velocity omega, which is constant. This is the velocity, therefore, if I divide by total angle, 1 ton is the 360 degree, which is 2 pi. So 2 pi divided by velocity, it will give me the time, how much it takes. So 2 pi to pi cancels out, so it is L2 omega. L2 omega. L2 omega I. This is the forwarding velocity. R2 dot is, it's the same. You take the derivative of this using chain rule, and IB, JB, you can replace by omega cross IB or JB. Then if you calculate the velocity of the each 3 points, you got this situation. So this is basically the summation of the rotating and the forwarding velocity. Therefore, it's the fastest at the top. Fastest velocity, and this velocity goes like this. This point velocity goes like this instantaneously, and at this point instantaneously velocity zero. So instantaneously it looks like this. If I draw this picture, then it looks much clear. This is the bar, center here, and it's falling in this direction. So instantaneously, there are many falling bars. Of course, in this side, it's not falling bar, it's a rising bar. I didn't teach it, but this point, the velocity instantaneously zero. This is the instantaneous center of rotation. Okay, that's it. Okay, I covered everything, so I wish you good luck with your final exam, and I will open the office hour. You won't have office hour in the next week, but I will open the office hour the 1 week before the exam started. That's the right after you return from the spring break.